Thank you so much. That was wonderful. That truly lifts us up this morning. We are so thankful for the gifts and talents that our folks here at Carrollton Christian Church use in ministry. Before I get started on the message, I forgot to mention, let's also keep in prayer our Trina. She hasn't been feeling well lately, and we need to keep Trina in our prayers as she just has had a cold, and she had her nose thing going on, you know, where she hurt herself, and I can't imagine having a sinus cold when you've had that, you know, so please keep our dear Trina in your prayers, and keep Adam and Roby in your prayers, because they're out Boy Scouting, and better them than me in that tent last night, so we'll keep them in our prayers as well. Also want to lift up, thank you for those that volunteered for our Stuff the Cruiser yesterday. We were able to fill 3 cars with food for the Carroll County Food Pantry. That's going to put a dent in filling the shelves at the pantry. So thank you for all who volunteered for that cause. It's always such a great time. This morning, I want to come to you from the Gospel of Matthew, the 25th chapter, verses 1 through 13. The parable of the 10 virgins. Beloved, let us hear the word of God this morning. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom. Come out and meet him." Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go gather to the dealers and buy for yourselves." And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered, "Truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." Thanks be to God for his precious and holy word this morning. Please pray with me this morning. O God of justice and love, you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light that we need and awaken us to the needs of others through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Now, this message was supposed to open with a video. Well, there'll be no video this morning because the video's not working. But you know what? God's still going to work this morning. Maybe some of you know this commercial. For years, we have been hearing Tom Baudet speak about Motel 6, and we'll leave the light on. For years, we have also known the Boy Scout motto, which is, be prepared. We have been told not to believe the world's gloom and doom experts that warn us of possible world events and tragedies. Here are some stories about what people said would never happen that came to pass, as to ease our minds. In 1938, George Fielding Elliott printed the following: "A Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor is strategically impossible." In 1948, Dale F. Zanuck, head of 20th Century Fox, wrote, "Television won't be able to hold on to any marketed captures after the first 6 months. People will soon grow tired of staring at a plywood box every night." I don't think they're plywood anymore, but Science Digest wrote in 1948, "Landing and moving around the moon offers so many serious problems for human beings that it may take science another 200 years to lick them." Beloved, this morning we gather together as people living in a world that seems to be out of control. A world of violence, a world of greed, a world which trusting and loving one's neighbor seems in short supply. We at times are impatient people, wanting gratification now. We have to have it now. We've got to have it now. And we often ask Christ, Lord, why have you not come back to save us yet? Where you been? Where you at? This morning I come to you with the message that we must be prepared and we must be ready and we must not grow weary and we must not grow impatient. This morning we see that Christ in the Gospel of Matthew is speaking a passion narrative. For our text in Matthew this morning, Jesus is telling the parable of the bridesmaids. We need to know that we do not know when Christ is returning. But we need to know that Christ is returning. And as I have so often said, it could be 100 years from now, or it could be before you take your next breath. Only the Father knows when His Son is going to return. Our reading this morning records Jesus' preaching God's final plan for the world that He created. Again, Jesus uses stories that the people can understand. He speaks of lamps of oil. I was going to have a lamp up here, but you know what? In the 21st century, it's hard to find a lamp like they had back then. So we'll just have to imagine lamps. That's why there's a lamp on the cover of your bulletin. Yes, Jesus speaks of lamps and oil, and He speaks of those that were prepared and those that are unprepared, as well as those that would not share. Jesus ultimately speaks about those whom God could not recognize when the end time finally does come. What Jesus communicates to the people is that they must be prepared and that His coming back is imminent. Meaning that God knows when God knows that Jesus is coming back. The imminent time that Christ speaks of is a time in which people must truly be prepared for. Christians have used lamps for the Word of God with which we see God's way. The image and the use of oil is often linked to our acts of baptism, which is an outward sign of an inward change that shows that we are truly prepared for what God has planned for this world and that we are willing to walk God's path in this world. Whether we read from the book of Amos this morning or from Paul's letter to the Colossians, they, along with Matthew's Gospels, are meant to prepare us for a world that God truly intends to change. God will have justice. We often say, there is no justice in the world. Well, folks, don't worry. God will have justice for this world. We must encourage others with the promise of the coming of the Lord and what will happen to those that have found themselves unprepared and those unwilling to share Christ with others. Today, maybe on TV, you see preachers talking about the prosperity gospel and how God wants you to be happy and how God wants you to have this. But are those preachers truly educating and preparing their congregants? Yes, God wants you to be happy. God wants you to have an abundance. But God also wants you to be prepared and to prepare others for His coming back. That is the promise of God. I think of these prosperity gospel preachers and what happens when God does return and they have not prepared their flocks and God doesn't recognize them. Are we the people that God created? Are we the people that follow God's call? Are we the people that prepare others rather than preparing ourselves for the riches and abundance of the world? God will have justice, and it will roll down like water. We must encourage others with the promised coming of the Lord. And what will happen to those that have found themselves unprepared and unwilling to share Christ with others? There is a new time at the end of time. What we must embrace this morning is the fact that Jesus tells us that with the coming of the end times, God has created and planned a new time for His followers. My friends, Jesus is telling us through His parable this morning key things. And these are key things. God is going to claim this world as to make a new heaven and earth. We must be prepared. We must share God with others. And ultimately, there is a time when it is too late and the unprepared. I hope this doesn't sound too cruel, but the unprepared are out of luck. It's too late. As we celebrate this Veterans Day, how many of our veterans understand this analogy? It's too late to attack the enemy from the front when they're at your rear. Amen? So how should we act? My friends, our call for Jesus is this morning is that we prepare for His return, that we must grow tired, not grow tired and weary, but instead have joy and have fulfillment, not dread or sorrow. We must utilize the gifts and energy to work in the now, and our call is to love and to serve our neighbor now. Often preachers wonder who is listening and what are the words that are being gleaned from their messages. We wonder, are the wise or the foolish listening? The snake-bitten, the self-satisfied, the hopeful, or those who have yet to meet Christ. Friends, when we gather, your pastor must prepare you to be touched and to be fed and to go out as a new thing every time we gather in worship. What did Pastor talk about today? A new thing. You see, each time we go to His holy written word, we find a new thing. We find something that we didn't read before. That's why we just don't read the Bible once and then put it away. Because each time we turn to this holy and written word, amen, we find something new. Something to encourage, not to discourage. Something to uplift us and not put us down. Something to give us hope, not hopelessness. Jesus tasked those in worship to be prepared to listen, to prepare to learn, and to be prepared to be touched and to fed as they go out. Yes, you must have your lamps well supplied with oil. Or as I told the kids, a fresh set of batteries in your flashlight. Yes, darkness is coming. Darkness will be here. We will not know when, but it is coming. Have we done all that we can do to be prepared? And have we done all that we can do to prepare others? Let's go to verse 12 of today's text. But he answered, "Truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, you know neither the day or the hour." My friends, Jesus is the bridegroom and we are the bride. Have we made the wedding preparations, or will the wedding day come and we will say, "We're not ready"? We were at Kroger yesterday and a bride came in with her mother. And how do I know it was a bride? Because she said, "I'm the bride," on her shirt. And I said, "When are you getting married?" "This afternoon." What are you doing? Well, we're going to get some stuff because we're not quite ready for this afternoon. And it was already 12:30. Beloved, I conclude this message this morning by uplifting you. When Jesus calls on his disciples to keep watch, he is calling them to take the reality of God seriously so that they and we can come to terms when he suddenly appears before us, possibly now or possibly at a later moment in our lives. My friends, go out today in joy and preparedness that the reality is that one day the kingdom of God will truly be here. I leave you with this question this morning. Will you leave your light on for God's arrival? Or will you run out of patience oil and be in the dark when he comes? The choice is ours to be prepared. We must go out this morning leaving the light on for Christ's return. You will be glad that you did. When Christ returns, the hope and the joy is that he will come to you and say, "My child, I know you. Let's go home." This is God's word for his people this morning. Amen.